Amen. Remain standing, please, and turn to the Bible, to maybe the most familiar passage in all of the Scripture, John 3:16, and we're going to kind of use that as a launching pad for our thoughts this morning. The Gospel according to John, John chapter 3:16. And we'll read a couple of verses to get it in a context, and then we'll launch from there. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light, and the light does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen that they have been done in God. May the Lord which blessed me to his word may be sanctified in our hearts. Can we pray together? Father, we thank you for your word, for the entrance of your word gives light. We lift your people up to you, Father. We pray their minds, their hearts, their souls, and their spirits will be open to receive what you have for them, and that your word will be sustenance to them, strengthen them, encourage them on every side to go about and do your will. We lift up Mr. Brian Jolly, the young man that was shot in the Institute community this past week. Lift up his family to you, Lord. We pray that you would bring encouragement to them, healing, Father, and we pray that they might be drawn close to you. Lord, we pray that you might touch the hearts of people who never come to faith in Christ today. They might be drawn. And those who are already in Christ, Father, they might be strengthened. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I will take this opportunity this morning to kind of to preach a little topical homily from this idea of why you should vote. Why you should vote. Why are you to cast your lot? It's my humble opinion that the United States of America may be the greatest experiment of self-government, of people governing themselves. And I was listening to a piece the other night where former United States Supreme Justice David Souter made a comment a few years ago. You know, he left the bench. He wasn't too old to continue to be on the bench. He was still young as Supreme Court justices go. Brilliant legal intellect. But he left the bench. And he makes very few public speeches, makes very few public appearances, and seldom does he comment on the social scene of the political landscape. 4 years ago, Justice Souter did make a comment. And he says, the thing that keeps me up at night is social ignorance. He goes on to quote from Benjamin Franklin, and Franklin says that the greatest threat to a democratic republic is social ignorance. When people stop paying attention, when people stop caring, when people stop holding the elected officials accountable. And he says that that can lead to tyranny. Because over time, what will happen is people will disengage, become socially, politically, and culturally ignorant, conclude that things are just too complicated to try to figure it out, and then say, let's just elect somebody that can fix all of this. Now, David Souter, 4 years ago, said that is the greatest threat to the United States Democratic Republic. He says it's not the threat of foreign invasion, because we're going to keep spending enough money. We're going to blow anybody out of the waters who would dare threat to attack us. And we got enough military might and weaponry to destroy the world several times over. If there's any doubt in anybody's mind what we would do if necessary, just go back to Nagasaki and Hiroshima, and we'll show you what we would do if we got to do it in terms of eliminating hundreds of thousands of people. But Suda says there is no protection from social ignorance. That burden rests upon the people to continue to engage, to continue to pay attention, to continue as best they can to hold politicians accountable for what they should be doing and how they should be doing it, and to continue to exercise their First Amendment right of free speech. This is a former Supreme Court justice now, so that's his greatest concern, and that's what keeps him up at night. And that's really why you ought to vote if you're registered to vote. If you're not registered to vote, then don't tell nobody. Don't tell nobody that you're not registered. Don't brag about it. There's nothing to brag about in a democratic republic. Because the most powerful expression of citizenship, the single most powerful expression of citizenship in a democratic republic is the right of franchise, the right to vote. So don't you brag about it if you're not registered. Now, if you can legally register to vote and you're not, don't brag about that. Because you're going to sound like that young preacher one time who would get up and he would open up his sermons by saying that I've never rubbed my head up against any college or seminary walls, bragging on the fact that he had not been educated. And Dr. Gardner Taylor pulled him aside and he said, son, you should never say that again. You should never get up and brag over the fact that you've not been to school and you've not had a decent education. You do not have to forewarn anybody, because when you start preaching, they can figure that out for themselves. So we shouldn't be boasting about we're not voting. But if we are registered, we should prepare and go out and cast our lot. So why should we do it? Well, I will lift a couple of simple principles from this passage and another passage. One of the reasons that we should vote if we are eligible to do it is because God loves the world. Despite its dysfunction, despite the fact that politicians lie to us, steal from us, deceive us, manipulate us, take advantage of us, abandon us, insult us, don't pay attention to us, God still loves the world. And in John's construct, there in John 3, when he talks about the world, he's not talking about the water, the trees, the land, the mountains. He's talking about the inhabitants of the world. God so loves people. God is concerned about people. God is concerned about the just and the unjust, the righteous and the unrighteous, the good, the bad, the ugly, the apathetic, and the indifferent. God still loves people, and God is concerned about people. And as long as people can inhale and exhale, God is concerned about what happens to them. We should vote because God loves people. And God has created a world, and he's put people in this world, on this earth. And on this earth, the people have to live under some form of government. And so the government, it shapes the environment in which the people can live. And so some governments are better than others. A totalitarian regime where the people are brutally oppressed, where they are exploited and taken advantage of, where they're worked like beasts of burdens and never allowed to benefit from the labor of their hands. That government is not on an equal par with a democratic republic that has a capitalistic free enterprise system for an economy. Those two things are not equal. All governments are not the same. And all governments do not have the same potential. A government where there is an emperor, a monarch, or a dictator, whereby the people have no rights but to serve the throne, to serve the king or the queen. That government does not have the same potential as a free society, a free government with a capitalistic free enterprise system. Now, free government with a capitalistic free enterprise system in and of itself is not necessarily inherently righteous, but it has the potential. It has the potential. It has the potential because within that system, it allows for people to have freedom of speech and freedom of the press and freedom of life and liberty and to own property and freedoms of certain amount of self-determination. The potential is there. Now, the potential of the government can be corrupted. People can still be exploited. People can still be put in slavery and Jim Crow and be oppressed when the government is not operating according to its own principles. But the principles are there. The principles are there to create an abolitionist movement whereby the government has to live up to its claims that all men are created equal and endowed by the Creator with certain inalienable rights among them in life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That's a founding principle. It just was violated, but the potential was there was to change it and to make it better and to create a more perfect union. So a capitalistic free enterprise economy in the context of a democratic republic where the people have some say as to who leads them and rules over them in formal government has the potential to do good. It doesn't have to always be sloppy. The system doesn't have to be rigged if it is. It can be made to be better. But as one of the great thinkers once said, the problem with a free government, the problem with that free government is when the people starts to fear the politicians, you end up with tyranny. In a free government, the politicians are supposed to fear the people because the power is supposed to rest and reside with the people. And the people are supposed to have the power to remove politicians from office who do not represent or act in the best interest of the people. And that's why you ought to vote. You ought to vote because you get an opportunity to vote people in and vote people out. To vote people in that you really believe are going to try to do right by those whom God loves. And God loves all the people. So the government ought to work for all the people. The way this system is designed is that whoever wins, they still are responsible for governing all the people. So they just can't say, I'm not going to listen to you because you didn't vote for me. No, they're responsible for governing all the people and being responsible to all the people. And so we ought to vote because God loves the people. God has placed the people on the earth. God has placed the people underneath governments. God has given the government certain authority to do certain things, so we need the best possible government that we can create, so we get the best laws and the best political leadership to create the best environment so the people can grow and flourish and pursue happiness. Oh, it really is important that you vote. Just going out and voting is important because if you merely vote, the politicians, after the election, they get the precincts, and they study the precincts to figure out who voted in these respective precincts. So we were here in the church. I'm not exaggerating, not making this up. Kenny Hale is my witness. And they were doing a voter registration, voter activation network training so we could understand how the voting system worked. And so the guy was going to use me as an example, and I was boasting over the fact that I had voted in every election far back as I can remember. And so he was going to fact-check me right there on the spot. So he fact-checked and went in this computer system. He went back, I don't know how many years, and he says, yes, the reverend is right. He's voted in every election for the last 18 or 20 years, how far back he went in the system. But then he went on to say, well, we didn't know that the reverend was a Caucasian male. That's the demographic. Somebody to put it in there. Can't hear what the man said. This the man was from national office. He had me in there right, but see, some kind of way you became a Caucasian male. So I just decided I'm going on ancestry.com. If they come back and tell me 51%, I want my inheritance. I want my money. I want it all. The 40 acres and the mule. And everything else that the watch people had, down through the generations, and the pain people, I want it all. My point is, I never knew that they kept all of those voting records. So a politician can look at a neighborhood and know who lives in that neighborhood. If you've lived in that neighborhood for any length of time, your voting record in the precinct that you're supposed to vote at is there. Either you went or you didn't. And they study that. I wish I was exaggerating. They came to us with the number, with the precinct. And so you got some of the lowest voting precincts in all of Kanawha County, maybe in all of West Virginia. And they pulled up the grand old west side of Charleston. And so we have some of the lowest voting precincts. So now I understand why nobody pay attention to it. And nobody listened to it. Let him talk. Let him holler. Let him scream. Let all those people there. Because we ain't going to do nothing because the people not going to vote. They're not going to punish us or make us pay at the poll. I ain't trying to tell nobody who to vote for, but I'm going to tell you to vote. Get out and vote. Cast your lot. Make the people pay attention to you. Make them know that you exist. And in this society, in a free enterprise system of economy, in a government that's a democratic republic, you don't matter to the people if you don't vote. They don't even count you as being a full citizen because you're not expressing that full citizenship franchise. So every time we vote, we're voting to make a statement. We care about what happens. We care about how the country and the state is governed. We care about how people are treated. We care that the government will be responsible for those that God loves. We ought to vote because God loves the people in the world, and God has not abandoned the people of this world, and God has placed people under government. And so Christian people will use all the influence that they have to try to create the best possible government they can so the people can be healthy and happy and enjoy life. The second reason that we are to vote is because God has sacrificed for the world. God don't just love the world, but God has sacrificed for the world. God has invested the best that heaven has to offer in the world. And sometimes, Deacon Overstreet, it's hard for me to buy into that because there are some people that I find it awful hard to get along with. And you look at people, just contrary people. We was up in Morgantown yesterday, and there was a young man that was in front of me who had some mental challenges. And he had his sister with him, and they were trying to get him. He's a grown man. I mean, he's 35, 40 years old. And his sister was trying to get him toward the back there so he could go to the restroom. Now, the one thing that I just have a problem with going to Morgantown, I love people. I don't particularly like crowds of people. I love people, individuals, small groups of people, talk to people, listen to people, enjoy people, but get me in a crowd of people, and I got a little bit of xenophobia. I'm looking for the exits. How am I going to get out of this? Is something break out up in here? And so as soon as we got up there, I ain't tell nobody. As soon as we got up there trying to get to our section 133, you know, up at Mountain, they got to blow stuff up. They got to shoot the cannon. They got to shoot the rifle. They got to shoot something. And so fireworks started to go off. I almost ducked and jumped under something. I didn't want to show the people that I got a little bit nervous because now I'm starting to think, what if somebody get to shooting up in here? How are we going to get up out of here? Now I'm getting really nervous. So I go back, and these people, another thing I don't like about Morgantown, I don't love a whole lot of crowds of people. I certainly don't love a whole lot of crowds of people when they got giant Budweisers and Miller Lights. I mean, them people drink up more beer than I've ever seen in my life, and the whole place just smells like beer. You know what I mean? Especially when you get out in the hallway. And so we're coming down, and this lady is trying to navigate her special needs brother, and they almost knock him down. I'm trying to tell you, the Holy Ghost had to grab me. I had my gloves on because I don't like for my hands to get cold. I had my tight leather gloves on. Now, if you're from the ghetto, you put on tight leather gloves. You know, if you think something might break out, just in case something break out. I mean, and something, I want to hit the man. I want to just slam up against the wall. You just running over this young man, you see he's having trouble navigating himself, and you in some great bigger hurry to get these two big cups of Miller Lite somewhere and so forth and so on. And you fail to realize that this young man needs special help. So as I look out at the sea of humanity there in Morgantown, all this gold and all this blue, and I'm just thinking, Lord, how many of these people are saved? If you were to come right now and snatch out the three or four from five from the Grace Bible Church and a few of the people, how many people here would be left? And I was just thinking about myself, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us. I mean, just have mercy on us. I mean, have mercy on us. We're here worshiping like football is a god. We got this big shrine up here. All the people's money tied up in this stadium, and we ain't caring nothing about you. I love football and all that, but I just couldn't help think about the fact of the situation. A lot of those people are living lives without Jesus Christ or getting ready to drop into a Christless eternity. But I was reminded, but God still loves the people. And God is concerned about everybody, and God has sacrificed for people. He got up off of the precipice of his eternal reign. He walked through 42 generations, wrapped himself up in human flesh in the person of Jesus Christ, walked across the Via Della Rosa to a place called Calvary on a mountain called the Skull, and was nailed to the cross, and his blood was shed for the beer-drinking, obnoxious people at Milan Pushkar Stadium. Because God loves the people. And God is concerned about the people. And we ought to vote so we create the best government we can, because God had made the ultimate sacrifice that he could possibly make, and that was his son, Jesus Christ, and his shed blood. And with all of his foibles and with all of his flaws, and I critique the United States of America, and I critique the state of West Virginia, I critique Kanawha County and Charleston, because I love all of those places, and you critique it to make it better, because it can be better. It doesn't have to be the way it is. Things do not have to be the way they are. They're often the way they are is because Christian people will not become socially engaged in a world of what's going on and to understand what's being said and what's not being said and use their influence to try to make people do what they ought to be doing, because it's right, because God loves the people, and God has sacrificed for the people. You're to vote because God loves the people. You're to vote because God sacrificed for the world's people. And we're to vote because God wants the world to be saved. Now, in the Greek text, the word saved has several applications. One of the applications has the idea of to be just delivered, to be safe. To be safe. That's what salvation is. You know, salvation is to be delivered from the pending wrath and doom that's getting ready to come, and to be safe in Jesus Christ. So when we are saved, it means that we are safe. We are safe under the protected covering. We are safe under the blood of Jesus Christ. We are safe and can never be separated from Christ. So to be saved is to be delivered, and to be saved is to be safe. To be safe. And so we ought to be concerned about particularly the children in our neighborhoods, in our community, them being saved spiritually, but also them being saved and them being safe. Amen. Them being safe, them being delivered. You know, I've written about this. I've written about the whole idea of what's happening to children, particularly on the west side of Charleston. The public schools have become the social pathological diagnostic centers. You go into elementary school, you diagnose the pathology and the pain and the brokenness of the community, and give me 2 hours to do it, and I can tell you what's wrong with the whole community. Because all I gotta do is go in the preschool room and the kindergarten room and the first grade room and the second grade room. I don't have no farther than that. No farther than that, because I go in those rooms and I see children who are sleep deprived, and who's responsible for putting them in the bed? I see children who are not motivated to learn. So one of the most unnatural things is for a child to not be motivated to learn. That's what it means to be a child, to want to know, to be inquisitive. So I see kids not motivated to learn. I see kids that are sleep deprived. I see children that doesn't have impulse control. They don't have impulse control because they've not been trained and nurtured in a way in terms of what's acceptable and what is unacceptable behavior, because they've been in environments where there's hollering and screaming and cursing and certain going on, and whoever's the loudest, the most vulgar, and the strongest, they win. So our children are not safe. They're not delivered. So now all the research is in. I don't have to go to no more of these workshops and all this to learn about adverse childhood experiences and the trauma of the brain. We knew that intuitively, didn't we? We kind of knew that from the Bible. We understand from the scripture, you train up a child in the way that they should go and they'll not depart from. We know from the Bible that foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child, and the rod of discipline, which means nurture and care, can drive it from them. So the things that we've known for a long time, and now the experts who've got another grant and got enough more funding from the National Science Foundation, write more articles and create more books, they're gonna tell us we're in bad shape. I wanna know what's the answer. How are we gonna fix it? I know the children have been traumatized, I understand that. I understand that they're all that's going on with them, but how in the world are we going to fix it? That's what I want to know. And what commitment are we willing to make? And how much are we willing to expend? And what sacrifices are we willing to make? Because it's not their fault. Whatever's wrong with them, none of it's their fault. None of it's their fault. It's the politicians' fault. It's their parents' fault. It's the preacher's fault. It's the church's fault. It's the police's fault. It's all the adults' fault who's responsible for saving and delivering and protecting the most vulnerable people. And that are, that's the children. That's the children. That's the children and the elderly. Now, you ain't got to protect the elderly but so much because they're the most powerful voting block in this nation. You see, the elderly, they vote at a higher rate than anybody else is voting. And when the AARP speak, all the politicians listen. Because they know that AARP, most of them, they spend all day talking about who they're going to vote in, who they're going to vote out, and you don't mess with the AARP. And every time somebody starts talking about doing something to Social Security, all of a sudden they get an epiphany. We can save Social Security. All of them say, we got to save Social Security. Why? Because the power of the AARP as a voting block. Well, there is no voting block for children because they don't get the franchise until 18 years of age. So for the first 17 years of their life, they are dependent upon somebody else to go to the poll and vote their best interests. Vote for their safety. Vote for their deliverance. Vote for their protection. You are to vote to try to protect those that God loves the most, and those are the children. Because pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the widow and the orphans in their affliction. You in the Bible, what it meant to be an orphan? To be an orphan in the Bible meant you didn't have no inheritance. Meaning you had no money. It didn't mean you didn't have no money. So if you didn't have no money, your father died and didn't leave you and your mama no money, you were an orphan as far as they were concerned in the Old Testament. Not that you didn't have a parent, you didn't have no money. You know the poorest adults in the United States of America? The poorest adults in the United States of America, according to the United States Census and a couple of those think tanks out of Washington, is black women. Black single mothers. You know the net worth of poor black mothers in the United States? $8. $8 is their net worth. So it means that they're in poverty, it means their children in poverty, it means that somebody got to figure out a way to try to help them in the raising and nurturing of children. Now we can talk about they shouldn't have had all those kids, right? And that's the same thing as talking about, well, once all the horses gone off the barn, who left the door open? What sense does it make who left the door open? Who cares who left the door open? Let's go and get the horses. Let's go and get the horses. And so the natural thing for people to do is to procreate. You're trying to go against nature now to say people are not going to procreate. Every species in the animal kingdom, they gonna procreate. Why did God tell Noah to bring them two by two? The whole principle of this country, the world, is they're gonna procreate and reproduce because God is trying to perpetuate the species. Let me close. I'm just about out of my time, but give me two more minutes and I'll be through. We're to vote because God loves the world, the people of the world. We're to go because God has sacrificed for the people of the world. We're to vote because God wants the people in the world to be safe, to be delivered, to be healthy. And then when they are healthy and they're doing well, you look to people and you say, don't you know where it come from? Don't you know where it come from? That's what we're to do as Christian people. We try to help people. We try to help them in the name of the Lord. And then we always put at the end of a little caveat, don't you know where that came from? That came from the good hand of God. Every good gift, every perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of lights. Everything that good that happens come from the Lord. And so when things start to get better, we try to let people understand it's not getting better by itself. It's getting better because God hadn't forgotten you. And God is not mad and angry with you. And God has not abandoned you. And you're to give God some time. You're to give God some time. As I look out over the congregation this morning, I ain't mad at nobody. Let me just do a double check. Let me just survey through the congregation this morning. I know I got bad eyes, don't see a whole lot. I look over there and we took a whole lot of kids with us yesterday. And I know they got back late. I know it because I think we rolled in around 12:30, something like that, because you got to stop and you got to eat. And you know, they tricked us, y'all. They tricked us. We stopped and let them eat. They ate up there at the place where they had sort of good chicken sandwiches, right? And they ate up a whole lot of food. Soon they got on the bus, And we don't get nowhere near Fairmont, and not too far past Fairmont. And then they say, well, we got to use the bathroom. Which we always say you do that before you leave the last stop. So we stop at one of those big sheets in the middle of nowhere. They got, I don't know how many gas pumps, and they got big, big. So we go in the sheets and use the bathroom, and what do? They go in there and buy soda pop and Gatorade and big old giant stuff. You know what I told them when they got there? You better save that cup. Didn't I tell them? You better save that cup. Because we can't get home. We ain't stopping at the next rest stop. We ain't stopping nowhere. Everybody to turn their head and hold on to your cup. Because y'all gonna put all that stuff in there. You know, if you put it in, it's got to go somewhere. But I look out there and I see one of the kids with us, Josh Martinez. Josh Martinez, the only kid that showed this morning. I know what's happened there. I know what's happened. His mama drug him out the bed. They grabbed him by the foot. Drug him out the bed and got him here. But I'm Sister Quincy. I see Sister Quincy just walked in. Amen. Amen. She walked in on cue, right on cue. See, that's my visual aids right there. I got two witnesses, young people who went to Morgantown, ate up as much food they could eat, drank as much drink they could drink up, hollered and screamed at the ball at the game, and had a good time. But two witnesses showed back up this morning to give God some time. That's what we got to teach our kids. And so we're to get out and vote. We're to get out and vote because God loved the people. God sacrificed for the people. God wants the people to be safe. God wants the people to be delivered. And we are to go out and vote because we believe it makes a difference. Don't you know if I didn't think that my life made a difference, I just wouldn't get up in the morning. I might get up, make it to the kitchen, then make it to the couch, and then make it to the restroom, back to the kitchen, back to the couch, if it didn't matter, but it does matter. And what we do matters, and our votes matters, and our advocacy matters, and lifting our voice really does matter, and trying to be on God's side really does matter, and trying to show people they count and they matter to God, even when they're living lives that disappoint us sometimes and discourages us. We keep lifting up the hope that you can change. It doesn't have to be that way. Give God some time. Give God a chance. Put your faith in Jesus Christ. You done tried everything else in the world of a politician? And all I got to say as I close in the word of one of my favorite politicians, what do you have to lose? What do you have to lose? I mean, you ought to give God, I'm saying give God a chance. What do you have to lose but your sin, your shame, and your guilt, and your hopelessness? I close with this. We had one of the most powerful politicians in West Virginia, and a group of us met with him a few weeks ago. And so he goes on this long tirade of how bad things are for black people. We ain't got nobody, ain't nobody with us, and we ain't got no hope, and nobody listening to us. All that stuff that we know. But he struck one nerve when he said, and y'all don't have no hope. And then when he said that, I said, Mr. So-and-so, Mr. Such-and-such, I got to beg to differ. We ain't got no political advocacy. We ain't got no political voice. We have no political champion. No one with cachet would speak for us. We're insulted. They ignore us. They act like we don't exist. But we ain't lost our hope. We ain't lost our hope. Oh, no. We ain't lost our hope. We ain't lost our hope. And y'all were there. Y'all, Rufus, I said, no, we lost our hope. I said, because our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' shed blood and righteousness. We dare not trust the free to spring, but hold on to his unchanging name. Oh, no, we ain't lost our hope. We ain't lost our hope. We're not looking for a political champion. We know that God's kingdom's not going to come in. He's not coming in on no elephant, and he's not coming in on no donkey. We're not looking for people on donkeys and elephants. The only time Jesus wanted to ride a donkey, he already did that. The next time, he's coming in on a white horse. That's what we're looking for. Until then, we're going to hold on to his unchanging hand, and we're going to keep on believing. And as I close, a round of the late Reverend Dr. Edward Victor Hill, better known as E.V. My brother-in-law's over at the big Moody Pastors Conference. And even here was preaching, he tells his own story. And he said, I was just a big old waterhead boy, born down in Sweet Home, Texas. My mama was poor and she couldn't take care of me. My mama gave me to my grandmama, and my grandmama raised me as her son. And he says, I was out there and I'd be working out there in the hot sun picking cotton and watermelon. And come in and my hands all blistered. And I would say, Mama, one of these days, I'm going to have me a house and a big old yard and a riding lawnmower. And Ed Hill said, all of the people out there working with him, listen, old big old head Hill. He ain't going to have no riding lawnmower. He ain't going to have nothing. And his grandma would say, keep on believing, boy. Keep on believing. And Hill said, down in Texas, you hear a car coming, you can hear it miles away. It's spitting out oil and big old cloud of smoke, man. You look around, that's the Negro's car. Old raggedy truck, the slop men coming to pick up the slop for the pigs. He said, it's my mom, one of these, I'm going to have me a long black car. He says, it's going to have an air conditioner. And it's going to be sleek and clean. And they said, look, old big Ed Hill. No ragged overhaul, combat boots. He ain't going to have nothing. Mama didn't even want him. His grandmama said, keep on believing, boy. Keep on believing. And Hill said when they worked the sharecroppers, he said the owner of the plantation would come and stand out on his big white veranda that wrapped all the way around his house. And he would come out every morning, and the Negroes would be out in the field, and he would stand up and he would stretch and look over his estate. And Hill said, one of these days, I'm in a house like that, with me a veranda. They laughed at Hill, and grandmama said, keep on believing, boy. Keep on believing. Hill said, I live out in Los Angeles, California. At that time, he had a deuce and a quarter. He said, I got me a long deuce and a quarter. He says, I have to have a truck to go before me saying, wide load when I drive through Los Angeles. And I hear the voice of my mama said, keep on believing, boy. Keep on believing. He says, I got me a house and I got a veranda porch. I get up every morning, do my morning devotion, read the Bible, walk out of my veranda, and I look toward heaven, he says, and I stretch. And I hear the voice of my grandmama say, keep on believing, boy. Keep on believing. I just stopped by to tell you this morning, Grace Bible Church, I don't know about you, but I believe that God called us to do something significant. And every morning I get up and I remind myself that God has called us to do something significant. So I'm going to stretch and I'm going to look toward heaven and say, Lord, I'm still trusting in you. I'm still believing in you. I do not believe you've abandoned us or forsaken us in your own time. You're going to come down and you're going to raise us up, and a mighty army is going to follow through faith in Jesus Christ. Oh, I can see it. I can see that. So I just encourage you this morning, keep on believing. Keep on trusting. Keep on hoping. Don't give up on your raggedy way with children and grandkids. You got too much invested. You sacrificed too much. You've given the days of you. You've spent all your money, invested everything you got. You might as well keep on believing and trusting in the living God. You got that cantankerous husband you can't get along with. You done gave him your youth. You done had his children and his baby. You done washed his clothes, fed his food. You might have hold on and keep on believing that the Holy Ghost might slap him and bring him to himself. Keep on believing. Keep on believing. Keep on believing. Keep on believing. You got a wife and been a faithful mate. Don't trade in for a new model, because you can't do nothing with these young women. They crazy, all of them. Hold on to the one you got and keep on believing and trusting in God, that God is still at work. Even when you can't see it. He's still doing things when you can't even see him doing it. Because he never slumbers. He never sleeps. I was talking to someone the other day, and they was talking all this big talk and this and that and the other. And I said, well, I know y'all can do all of that, because y'all got all the equipment to do it. I said, so y'all are just like a contractor. And y'all got one of those big earth movers. And y'all can come down with one scoop, scoop up two or three, you know, tons of dirt, or however much you can, cubic yards, and in a day's time, y'all can dig a hole so big. I know y'all can do all that. I said, but All me and my friends got it. We just got a teaspoon. But every day, we go and dig. We dig every day. We dig all day. We dig every day. We dig all day. And I tell you what, after 25 or 30 years, come back and look at the hole. So the people who started digging before we started, they hand us a spoon and we've been digging and we done dug up a whole lot of stuff. Don't underestimate what can happen if you just stay at it. And that's why we want 24-hour prayer vigil. We believe that prayer moves the heart of God. Prayer activates the hand of God. We want to see God move, God's hand activated, and we want to see something big happen. Amen? We want to see something big happen, so when we stand back, we can say, we told you what God could do. We want to be able to say to our children, look at what God has done. And that's what the testimony we want to have, to say to the broken, dysfunctional people on the west side of Charleston, look at what the Lord has done. Don't you want to serve him? Don't you want to know that God didn't abandon you, didn't leave you when everybody else had abandoned you? That's what the church is about. Stand in there and keep trying until God shows up, and then giving him the glory and pointing people to him. I'm out of my time. I thank you for yours. Let's pray together.